My honor and pleasure to be here with Professor Aaron Gross, who is a professor of Jewish studies, focusing on ethics in particular, at the University of San Diego, and is the founder and CEO of Farm Forward, and also of the Jewish Initiative for Animals, which is a part of Farm Forward. So thanks for taking this time to talk.
Thanks for having me.
So what I'd love to chat about is the interlocking oppressions of racism, sexism, and animal abuse. When we look at these issues, do you see a connection, and if so, what?
Yeah, absolutely there's a connection. And it's something that's been occupying me more lately. You know, for a long time, I think people in this movement, myself included, sense that there's some relationship. But it's becoming clearer to me that these things aren't just connected in tangential ways. It's not just that, you know, all oppressions are connected. It's that we really are dealing with a unified kind of oppressive system that puts the, you know, white male at the top, and it's bad for humans, women, and people of color all at the same time. And it's really a unified system in ways that I've really only seen recently.
So what are some ways we see that playing out? That the intersectionality actually affects one another in some sense.
Yeah. Well, most people can observe that, you know, vegetarians are more likely to be women, statistically speaking, right?
Oh,
there's a greater kind of sensitivity there. Well, let's think about, you know, why that is. Is that because, you know, men don't care about animals? Well, this is clearly not the case, but it does have something to do with how men are trained in the world, right? A young boy expressing compassion for an animal is likely to be derided, right? So this is you know, bad for that child, you know, but it's also bad for society. It trains men in insensitivity in a way that simultaneously projects it towards animals, but that also is going to be carried with that person towards how they deal with human beings. You know, we're more likely to, you know, teach men that, you know, the things are there for them. The animals are there for them to eat. The women's bodies are there for them to use. Other people are there for them to exploit. And it sounds like those are different things at first until you see that they're connected. So this was really lit up for me with the agriprocessor scandal of many years ago, which moved a lot of us who are Jewish and concerned with these issues, where you had human rights abuses talked about one year. Animal rights abuses talked about another year, and it never made it into the media, but there were also real problems with harassment and sexual violence going on there. And these things happened in the same place, at the same time, under the same management, and yet we dealt with them in the public as if they were separate issues. But it's kind of stretching it to say something that happens in the same place, same time, by the same people. It's just unrelated.
Yeah, part of this seems to be the boundaries of the fulfillment of one's pleasure when you have undefined power and privilege, and how do we sort of educate that from a younger age? I mean, there's technical solutions around legislation, but then there's a sort of adaptive challenges around how do we rethink the structures of society and how do we rethink education in this regard. I think when you just brought up a child. I guess there was a child who was recently committed suicide who apparently was vegetarian or vegan and was heavily bullied for this. And there's this male culture, which is kind of built upon this bullying mentality.
So as soon as you start to pay attention to this, you'll see it kind of light up. That there's a way of bringing people into the world where they can be sensitive towards others, or they can be kind of trained to be less sensitive. And we have a system which brings these three forms of oppression together right from day one. It's not like they're apart and then they get connected down the road.
So how does our understanding this more deeply impact how we think about our animal abuse work?
I think it challenges certainly single issue campaigns where we isolate one particular animal abuse, and really more broadly, isolating animals as a separate issue. You know, it suggests we have to deal with these issues together. If we're serious about animals being in a different situation where they don't suffer this kind of exploitation, we have to address the plight of women and people of color, even if it's not normally the way charitable and activist work happens. In fact, part of what may prevent the progress is that we are all divided up. That people who do anti-racism are likely to see vegetarians as dealing with something unrelated to their concerns.
Now, I know a lot of superstars who are concerned with many, many issues, But oftentimes I find, as you alluded to, that in certain vegan circles or animal rights circles, they're not necessarily thinking about racism, sexism, immigrant rights, refugees. And I find in many social justice circles, they have sensitivities towards a whole range of issues, but then serve, beef at their events. So I wonder, what are some of these barriers to kind of seeing the picture more broadly, and how do we kind of educate towards that?
Yeah, well, one thing I would say is there's certainly nothing wrong with somebody having a passion for a particular issue.
Yes, right.
Right? And we can, differentiate, an individual who's particularly energized from how we analyze overall, oppression. I mean, I think folks who are concerned with a broad range of human issues and neglect animal issues, which is certainly a large contingency, they're missing something. Yeah. And they may, in fact, find that their inability to make the kind of progress they want on their anti-racist or, pro-feminist work is related to the fact that they're missing, they're reinforcing at the end of that day by serving that burger, the idea that ultimately other beings are here for us to consume. Mm-hmm. And that idea, if you're teaching it to people right after your event while you're trying to reduce, say, sexual violence, is ultimately undermining some of the work you're doing.
Yeah.
So it's, I think talking about this is really key.
Right.
And I really want to give a shout out to some of the people I've been reading lately. There really is a tremendous amount of thought on this coming from, I would call the vegans of color community. But in particular, there's a set of sisters, Af and Sil Co. They just came out with a book called Afroism, which really goes deep into this.
Yeah.
And when you start to listen, you're moved. I was moved to realize, even though everything in terms of how donations work and organizations are structured encourages me to focus on animals in a kind of narrow way, that just can't be the future of the work I want to do.
I wonder if you've thought at all about prisons. People of color, of course, are disproportionately represented in mass systems of incarceration, and the prison cell, and I've been inside many to visit or to counsel or whatever the case is, seems to deeply resemble factory farming. And I wonder if you thought about that.
Oh, yeah. I mean, 100%. Yeah. I mean, there's actually, I think, an affinity to thinking about the injustice of the prison system to folks in the animal movement that I've kind of noticed anecdotally. But for me, absolutely. I mean, we're dealing with, again, a system that puts the white male on top. Mm-hmm. And, of course, if you pay attention, but for most of us, it's news that, the prison system as we have it really was formed post-slavery as a way to control, black and brown bodies.
Yeah.
And that is part of the same system, as difficult as it, can be to talk about these issues, mm-hmm. that lets us take other vulnerable bodies and control them at our will.
Yeah.
I want to name how difficult it is, mm-hmm. At least for me, to, try to talk about these anti-racist issues with, all the integrity I'd want. Because I know my social location doesn't always help me see the things. Mm-hmm. And that's why, I wanted to do that call out. But when you start to discuss, when you start to find ways to overcome that discomfort, which is why I was naming it, I think we quickly will see people lighting up and recognizing these connections. Certainly with my students, when I talk about them, it's actually an easy sell. They're often like, oh, well, yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. So I think my last question for you is, we talked a little bit about how white supremacy and racism and sexism can inform animal abuse. But if we look inside the animal welfare, animal rights, animal liberationist world, I may be wrong, but it looks to me like primarily empowered by white men. And I wonder if we look within our own movement, if you see a room for improvement and where you see challenges there as well.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I know. I mean, that's in some ways the force of this realization that it's not just one issue among others, but an urgent issue. If we want a really vibrant movement that's going to challenge factory farming, I think this is crucial to the work we have to do. We have a very white movement.
Right.
We have a ton of female leadership.
Right.
But as you go to the top, as you start to look at the CEOs and the EDs of organizations and top funders, it really does become even wider and all of a sudden much more male. So it's a profound problem. And, what I want to name here is it's not just a problem for women and for people of color.
Right.
It's weakening our ability to really go after the structures that we want to go after.
Yeah, yeah. Wonderful. Well, I wish you so much continued success in this amazing work. Yeah, thank you so much. Good.